Hi, my name is Meadow Kouffeld, and I am an instructor in the Natural Resources Department here at Itasca Community College. Today we're in Daly Hall, where the Natural Resources Department is housed. Welcome to our Focus on Natural Resources Career Day. Today we'll be exploring the career path of forestry. We'll be interviewing with one of the professional foresters that is actually an instructor here on campus on dendrochronology.
Hi, my name is Kaylee Schoonmaker and I work at Itasca Community College. I'm a recruitment and retention specialist, and so I work in academic advising, student life, and recruitment. So at Itasca, we have lots of great clubs that you can join, activities, organizations. So we have Natural Resources Club, we have a Society of American Foresters, the Site Club, the Student Senate, the Campus Crusade for Christ. I mean, whatever you're interested in, you name it, we have something like that. So we have 20 plus clubs that you can join, and I highly recommend it. It's a great way to get involved and meet people, and of course it looks great on a resume too. We have lots of great amenities at Itasca for students, and so I think that's a great thing about Itasca is that even though we are a small school, we're very affordable, we have all these great things for students to utilize. So we do have a fitness center fully loaded with any equipment you might need to be working out. We have a weight room, we have a gym. We have a food pantry where students can come and get some free food. It's basically like a little grocery store. You can just come in and get food. And we have the on-campus housing too. So we have pretty much anything you might need right here on campus. There is always something fun happening at Itasca. We do all kinds of things and everything is always free for students. So we have our annual Blizzard Week where it's just a week of fun. And this year we're doing dog sledding and we have a virtual escape room, virtual bingo, snowshoeing. And outside of Blizzard Week, we do stuff pretty much a couple times a week. Almost every day we have some stuff going on. We take trips out to Mount Itasca to go skiing, snowboarding, tubing. We take kayak rides, bike rides. We have free nights at the movie theater, free nights at the bowling alley, the roller rink, movie nights on campus, like all kinds of fun stuff that students can tap into. We have lots of equipment that students can use. So of course we're located in the beautiful Northwoods and we love being outside. So anytime you want, we have kayaks, canoes, snowshoes, camping equipment, fishing equipment, all kinds of fun stuff that students can use free of charge. Also bikes too, if you want to bike around town. We are really excited to be opening our brand new student center in August of 2021. And it's gonna be a great place for students just to connect and have fun. And so there'll be a coffee shop in there. There'll be a ping pong table, pool table, a video gaming area with big screen TVs and big comfy couches, a place to rent the outdoor equipment, a fireplace. For athletics at Itasca, we have men's basketball, football, wrestling, and baseball. And then we have women's basketball, softball, and volleyball. We also have a co-ed trap shooting team. So lots of fun stuff to do. And we have a lot of school spirit here, so it's fun to go out and watch the games. We also have intramural sports, which are just more for fun, just playing against other students on campus, basketball, dodgeball, eight ball pool, all kinds of stuff.
Hi, I'm Ryan DeSantis. I'm an instructor of forestry and natural resources at Itasca Community College. Today we're going to talk about forestry and eventually we'll talk about dendrochronology. I've done a few different things in my career in forestry. So I've worked for state government, I've worked as an extension forester, and now I'm an instructor at Itasca Community College. So foresters do a number of different things. Some of the things they do outside include tallying trees. So you'll notice in this forest, there are some tags on these red pines. Now this forest has been continually monitored for many, many, many decades. And they've kept track of the growth and the height of these trees. This is all a red pine plantation. So foresters do a number of different things for a number of different organizations. So they might work for a place like the DNR or the US Forest Service or as a private consulting forester. So we're in a red pine plantation here on the ICC campus. There are a few other tree species in this stand. Behind me is a mature red pine, and you'll notice there are some characteristics to this tree that we can use to identify this as a red pine. So one of the things right off the bat is the color, the texture, and the shape of the bark and the bark scales. We can also look up into the canopy of this tree, or if we had a younger red pine, we could look at the needles of the tree and we can compare that to other tree species as well. So we mentioned red pine. We are in a red pine plantation, but there are other tree species in here as well. So this is a red maple, and you'll notice that the bark is much smoother. Now, part of that is because this is a younger red maple tree. As it gets older, it will have furrows or ridges in the bark like that older red pine had. But we can use characteristics like bark, and we can also use the foliage on these trees to distinguish between different tree species. We'll also talk about the wood inside the bark and how we can distinguish between those tree species with the wood as well. So we've talked about red pine. There's also eastern white pine in this forest stand. So this looks a little bit different. To begin with, the bark is smooth, again, mostly because this is a young tree. As it gets older, the bark will become more furrowed. It'll have deeper ridges like the red pines. The needles on the eastern white pine are different than the red pine, and the form is different as well. So you can notice the branches on the eastern white pine stick mostly straight out. As the tree gets older, they'll actually sweep up a little bit, which is different than our red pine branching. So we've taken a look at red pine and eastern white pine foliage, which are these needles. This is a balsam fir, and you'll notice the length of the needles is a lot shorter. So this is another type of conifer or evergreen. So a conifer or evergreen is going to keep its needles more than 1 year. So through the winter, trees like red pines and balsam firs are still going to have their foliage on them, whereas all the deciduous trees lose their leaves. So that would be red maples and oaks. So why are tree rings important? Well, one thing they can tell us is our annual rate of growth. So we can measure these trees and we can take a look at volume. We could measure height and diameter of these trees. We can also take a core out of these trees, or with trees that we are going to cut down or that are already dead, we can take a disc and take a look at the tree rings. And those rings are going to tell us something about the annual rate of growth for those trees. So there are a few things we can measure. One of them is mean annual increment. That's the average annual growth of that tree. And that's going to tell us whether our trees are growing adequately. So we can also use our volume and our height and our diameter. Those can tell us something about the site that these trees are growing in. So there's something called site index, and that's something that uses the tree species, data on those tree species that tells us how fast that tree should grow. And then we go out, we measure height and diameter, and we determine if that tree is growing in a good site. So we know, for example, with red pine, that our site index should be about 55 or 60. And a good site would be anything 60 or above for red pine. So we can use things like tree rings to help us determine the age of the tree and whether or not it's growing adequately and whether the site is a good spot for a species like red pine. So how do tree rings work? So each pair of dark and light is actually 1 year of annual growth. So the innermost circle on this disc is called the pith. So the pith is the center of the tree, and that's the first year of growth. That's when the tree was in its first year of growth. Each year that tree grew, it put on another ring of growth. And the outermost ring just inside this brownish reddish color is the last year growth. Now, your discs were cut from trees that were still growing last year, so that outer year is actually the year 2020. So this outer part, the bark, is what we call phloem. Just inside that phloem is a very thin layer, so thin that you probably cannot see it on these discs. That thin layer is called cambium, which is actually the only living the only layer of cell replication and growth on the entire tree, on the main stem of the tree, is in that cambium. Just inside the cambium, all of this in the middle, this is all xylem, which is basically wood. So again, the outside, our bark, is phloem, the inside is xylem, and each time a layer of xylem is added, that is one more annual growth ring. And again, we're using these layers or these annual growth rings and the variation in the widths of those growth rings to figure out years of or dry years or years of drought. All right, if you have your own tree disc, you can use those discs to follow along with the exercise. Otherwise, just follow along with the video and you can take a look at what we're gonna do with our tree discs. So our wood or xylem on the inside of the tree is made up of three basic things: lignin, cellulose, and hemicellulose. It's also made up of a small amount of something called extractives. And a fun fact is one of the extractives that can be found in tamarack is something called arabinogalactin, which is a chemical that they use in Lonza, which is in Cohasset, that they use to create a vitamin C substitute. So there are a lot of chemicals that they can use from extractives, which is actually part of the wood of the tree. So we're going to take a look at what these annual growth rings and what the wood tell us about tree species or where a tree grows in terms of site, competition, or variations in climate. Let's talk about how tree rings work. So each pair of dark and light is basically 1 year of growth. So you can see, for example, here there's light and then dark. Now remember, we're counting from the inside out. So this center is our pith, or the center of our tree. This is year one of growth. This is year two and year three. Each dark line is the end of that year of growth. So this inner part that's all the lightish color with the combination of light and dark rings, this is what we call xylem or wood. The outer part, this is all bark or phloem. In between the phloem and the xylem is a thin layer called cambium. That cambium is the only actively growing layer or area of the main part of the tree. Now on the inside of that cambium, we grow wood, and on the outside we grow bark. Each time we're growing more wood on the inside, we're depositing one annual growth ring, and we're also depositing a smaller layer of bark each year for research as well. So this is a red pine, and you can see a few different things here. So one thing to take a look at is it almost looks like the center of the tree is not in the center of the disc, right? So this tree was actually putting a larger amount of wood on this side of the tree, probably based on the direction the tree was leaning. So this is actually something called reaction wood, and the tree is compensating for leaning by trying to pull itself more upright and putting a larger amount of wood on one side than the other. So you'll notice that when it does this, the rings on one side of the tree then are going to be wider than the rings on the other side of the tree, where they look more narrow. So we can also take a look at the variation in ring widths. So we're looking at how wide and how narrow the rings get. So you'll notice right here, they're about the same widths, and then all of a sudden right here, they're a lot more narrow. Then they get wide again, and then by the time we get up here, they're more narrow again. And that's probably due to weather. It could be related to things going on in the forest and trees next to this tree, but most likely these growth rings are related to weather. So these wider rings were probably years that were wetter. So we got more rain or potentially more snow. There was more available resources, more water for this tree. So it was able to put on more growth in those years. In these narrower years, these could have been years that were drier or more drought years. So this is an ash tree, and you can see again some really good demonstration of growth ring patterns. So you can see here we go from really wide growth rings right here to really narrow. And even in here, we've got another band of a few years where it was probably wetter, and then a number of years where there are a number of very, very narrow growth rings. That also could have been due to competing vegetation. So this tree was maybe only 30 years old at that point, or maybe 50 years old. And we can see that at that point, maybe it was competing with other trees and it didn't get enough sunlight, enough water, enough resources, so it was growing much slower during those years right there. So another thing about this ash disc is that you can see that again, our center of the tree is a little bit offset. It started off with some fairly roundish circles, but over time, it started putting on more growth on one side of the tree than the other. And that could have been due to a few different things. Likely it was because it was growing in a wet area and it may have started to tip in one direction, so it was trying to offset that lean and put on more wood on one side of the tree to pull itself up straighter so that it could keep growing towards the sunlight. Okay, so we just talked about why we care about tree rings and what we can do with them. Some actual research applications of tree rings include climate history, so we can learn something about the weather or weather averages, for example, precipitation or even temperature, or fire scars help us determine the fire history of a forest stand. We can also figure out historical archaeology. So out west, they use a lot of living trees and they can do something called cross dating. So again, I mentioned the pattern of ring widths. Well, they can use those patterns and they can trace back timbers in historical buildings out west and figure out from what year that wood was cut and from what civilization built those structures. So there's a number of different applications of tree rings for research. There are also practical applications that we've talked about as well. There's something called the NOAA, or National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration. They have a tree ring data set online that has a lot of different tree ring data sets that people can use. Okay, this is a 200-year-old oak that we're looking at, and each one of these that you're looking at here, these are all scars from different fires over those 200 years. So you'll notice that they form a pretty characteristic looking scar in this disc. And we talked about each one of these rings equaling 1 year of growth. So we can actually figure out how old this tree is, and then we can actually figure out what the date of each of these fire scars stemmed from. So with each of these fire scars, you can see that the tree actually closed up the wound after a few years. So the fire was in this year, and then it looks like it took a few years, and then eventually it actually closes off that wound to prevent any other disease from entering the tree. So these are actually called wound ribs, and they're a way that the tree basically heals itself.
Well, thank you, Ryan, for giving us a demonstration on dendrochronology and explaining kind of how trees grow. And that's kind of at the foundation of being a forester, trees and growth, right? So maybe tell us a little bit about yourself. You know, this is a career-oriented program, so we want to know how you became a forester and how you got to today. So where are you from, Ryan?
So I'm from New Hampshire. I got my bachelor's forestry in New Hampshire, and then I spent a couple years in the Peace Corps working for a forestry office in Bulgaria with a national park. I came back and got a master's in ecology, worked for the Park Service and U.S. Forest Service for a few summers, and then I went to Oklahoma State for a PhD in natural resources and forest resources. From that, I worked with the U.S. Forest Service on a research job with the Northern Research Station. We looked at emerald ash borer and different climate scenarios and how different things were going to affect forests in the future. After that, I worked in Northern California for three and a half years as an extension forester. So I set up workshops, worked with private forest landowners and industry, and did lots of educational events. After that, I worked in Wyoming as a forest health program manager. And then from that job, I came here to Itasca Community College, where I'm an instructor of forestry and natural resources.
Well, that is quite a trajectory. That's really cool. Some of those things I can find intimidating, at least I did when I was younger as a student. And so it's hard to see kind of that, the big picture and take it in all at once. So obviously it doesn't happen all at once, right? So what was your educational path? What did you do to get to where you are today?
That's a good question. To be honest, at the time, I never thought that I would end up doing what I did and end up where I am today. So just a random piece of advice is to keep your mind open. There are a lot of different career paths. I started off thinking I'm interested in forestry. I'm interested in the outdoors in general. I thought about maybe a degree in wildlife. Somehow I ended up in forestry. Since I grew up in New Hampshire and Maine, they're by percentage the two most forested states in the country. So maybe I was just supposed to become something in forestry, but I spent a lot of time outside. I liked being outside. I liked being in the woods. And so that kind of led me into forestry.
Okay. So you were an outdoors oriented person when you were younger. Okay.
Yep.
Well, I think that kind of leads into, so forestry, there's a lot of aspects, and like you kind of alluded to, there's a lot of career paths or trajectories in forestry. What kind of person would probably find forestry an interesting career path?
So anybody that likes being outdoors, anybody that either wants to be something from like a conservation officer to a forester where they're actually cutting trees down and using those trees for forest products, somebody that's interested in wildlife, or somebody that just enjoys being outdoors in general. We have a lot of different parts of forestry, from tree identification to forest products to forest ecology. It's a field that I think there's a lot of different aspects. You can get into a lot of different jobs within forestry.
Okay. And so I guess what kind of is the goal in general of forestry? I mean, why is it important?
Right. So we've done a lot of things to forests over thousands of years. There's probably no forest out there, even in national parks, that hasn't been affected by people at some point. So we do have basically managed forests everywhere we look. So we've pushed them into some sort of trajectory that they are what they are now because of how they've been affected in the past by people. So there's a lot of different reasons why we have different land ownerships, like National Park Service, Forest Service. All of those different landowners have a different role in forestry. Some of them want to just set the forest aside and not manage it. Others want to actively manage it. But we've affected all of those different pieces of forest, and what we do now has a pretty important effect on what those forests are going to look like 10, 20, 50, 100 years down the road. So if we want a specific kind of a forest or a specific product to get out of the forest, like the paper we use every day or the building products we use, those are all things that we need to manage a forest to extract those products from the forest. The other thing is, most water either comes from a forested area or flows through a forested area. So our effects on those areas is profound. We usually need to do pretty complicated management in those areas if we're going to work in those areas. But sometimes we need to do things in order for a big disturbance not to affect those areas and then affect our water supply. So for example, out west in a city like Denver, they have a really big interest in the forests and the foothills and the mountains to the west of the city. They need to make sure that there are trees. Without the trees, that's going to affect the water supply, and they're not going to have enough water for the people who live in that city.
That's interesting. I think in Minnesota, we take water for granted. And so, I'm from California, and water is definitely a limiting resource and something that people are really focused on. So it's interesting to hear you also have that perspective because you've worked out west. And so thank you for that. So what is, I guess, your favorite part about forestry or being a forester? And maybe like what has kind of been your favorite part of your career trajectory? You've done some pretty cool stuff. So maybe let us know about that.
So one of my favorite things that I've done is actually work on tree rings like we talked about. Mm-hmm. So I did some fire history work, and that was pretty fascinating because we looked at what people were doing 200 and 300 years ago, and we could tell what they were doing based on the fire scars and the position of those scars in the wood. We could tell what time of year the fire scar was, and that could tell us whether it was probably either from a human or whether it was during the dry season where you might get lightning and it caused those scars. So I found that blend of kind of history and biology to be pretty fascinating. That was pretty exciting work. I've also enjoyed working outside, so I got to work in the Tetons for a summer. I worked on fire crews out west and in the Northeast for another summer. So probably one of the more enjoyable things about forestry that I've liked is that not only do you get to work outside, but sometimes you have to work outside, and that forces you to work outside in some adverse conditions, and that actually ends up making you have a whole different level of appreciation for being able to work outside.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think that is probably, like you said, what appeals to a lot of people getting into the field is also getting to travel a little bit. And you mentioned fire. A lot of foresters are involved with fire, correct?
Yep, that's right.
So why are foresters typically involved with fire? I'm kind of curious as to why that is.
So there's certainly a lot of people in fire that are focused on protecting structures. Mm-hmm. In natural resources, there are wildland firefighters, and they focus on protecting, trying to protect structures by affecting the fuels around them. So that would be the forest and the fuels that are in the forest and the trees that might be catching on fire. So they have to know something about those forests in order to be able to protect them from fire and to work with fire in those forests. So often those people start off with some background in natural resources or forestry. Or some background in fire / natural resources, okay. And then they move into more of a career in wildland firefighting, which is basically outside, either in a kind of a grassland ecosystem or a forest ecosystem.
Hmm. I always wondered, why is it that foresters like fire? But it makes a lot of sense, that, you know, especially when it comes to understanding how a fire behaves and why it may behave in different areas on the landscape. So, you know, it's an interesting perspective and, you know, again, an interest. Those people have an interest in natural resources and being out in those places, and so they're better suited to it for those reasons as well. Anything else that you might want to add or think students might find interesting or pieces of advice?
I would just advise to keep your mind open to a career in the future. So again, in forestry and natural resources, there's a lot of different things you could do. If you enjoy being outdoors at all, then I would keep your mind open to natural resources and forestry. And again, it could be wildlife, it could be forestry, it could be wildland firefighting, but there's a lot of different fun things that you can do outdoors with a career in natural resources and forestry.
All right. Yeah, I mean, it takes you to some amazing places, especially earlier in your career when you're kind of figuring things out. And
yep.
I kind of liken it to a career with built-in adventure. Yep. A lot of people take vacation to do the things that you or I, as natural resources professionals, would do for work. And that's kind of the perk.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's right.
All right. Well, it's been great, Ryan. Thank you so much for your time. And I really appreciate you explaining some of these things that maybe help some of these students understand some of the careers in natural resources. And also maybe the programs that we offer here at Itasca Community College.
Thanks a lot.
All right, thanks, Ryan.